Дамы и господа,
ladies and gentlemen, the time has come for us to start this plenary session devoted to the economic development of the Arctic. It is a concluding session, but as the British say, the last but not the least. And due to a whole number of obvious reasons, the economic interests have always been the main driver behind the Arctic policy of all of the stakeholder countries. The economic interests, the business interests have been the reason for many polar expeditions, making substantive contributions to the national budgets, creating the financial basis for the work in the Arctic. And finally, something which is really important, it is the economics, which create employment and income to the people of the North. And in our debate about the Arctic and against all of its geopolitical importance, one should always understand that this is the area of the habitat for a great number of the northern people who need work, who need future, and the sources for their current livelihood, as well as a certain hope for the good future for themselves and their children. So with this in mind, one should say that the current economic situation in the Arctic is dramatically different from the one which, I may say, we remember 3 years ago when we had the previous conference. The serious changes are obvious, and I must say that these changes are not for the good of the Arctic. I shall start by saying that the political attention to this region undoubtedly remains, but nevertheless, at the level of big politics in the Arctic itself, in the Arctic nations, in the third countries which show interest towards it, greater focus is distracted towards a whole number of complicated crises which are taking place in the southern latitudes of the world along this big curve of the crisis, from Brexit to the immigration crisis in the sea in the west and all the way down to the South China Sea and the Korean Peninsula in the east. Without doubt, the Arctic remains in the limelight of the interested government agencies, but I would describe it as rather being viewed as well-maintained backyard, allowing us to pay more attention to more urgent problems. Purely economic hesitation is not for the better. Its status as the resource appendix to the global economy is not a good one, but with the commodity prices falling down, we can see that objectively the economy in the Arctic is even more complicated. We are witnessing a whole number of resource development industry projects being put on hold, very slow development of the Arctic shelf. And finally, we see that in the area of the global politics, a lot of attention is being paid to developing global trade and investment blocks, where if the Arctic is participating, it is rather somewhere in the periphery of attention, which certainly doesn't mean that these blocks are not going to try and influence it. They will certainly try and do that, but to a certain extent, the level of priority in the eyes of the businesses and the decision makers has certainly fallen. That is why it would be nice to be able to have a conversation in this gathering about the kind of place that the Arctic may have in the future global economic development, in the future cooperation between the Arctic and non-Arctic states. And I would certainly like it not just to be a review of the work done, which is very often the case at the economic conferences, but somehow to try and excite ourselves to raise a certain discussion and try and find answers to basic questions. What's the outlook for the economic development of the Arctic and the economic component of the multilateral cooperation in the Arctic? What, for example, the Arctic Council can do or should do in this Another question, new technologies in the Arctic, on the one hand, they raise a lot of hope for its future development, but on the other hand, this does facilitate competition in the Arctic involving other regions. So this is the range of questions which I would ask today's panelists participating in this panel to look into. We're quite fortunate. We have a very diverse panelists. Almost all of them are the individuals who have had experience in working both in the businesses and in the government administration and science, which would make it ever more interesting to hear, listen, and make comparisons. Well, after this introduction, I would like to give the floor to Dmitry Fishkin, who represents the Ministry for Economic Development of Russia, Deputy Director of the Inter-Regional and Cross-Border Cooperation Development Department. Dmitry will tell us about the ministry's approaches and the government approaches to the issues of developing the Russian Federation Arctic Zone. Thank you very much for this. Well, I'm sorry to interrupt, just not for not more than 7 minutes, please. Okay. Well, today, during the opening session, our leader, the head of the Government Commission for the Arctic Development, Dmitry Rogozin, already described the approaches which we are currently developing from the point of view of social and economic development of the Arctic, and so I shall try and elaborate on these approaches. The conditions of economic development in the Arctic when this development is taking place in an erratic way while being concentrated around certain hubs dictates to us the need to undertake a project-based approach. Essentially speaking, the development of the Arctic zone of Russia is where we talk about project implementation, and as part of the government commission task execution for the development of the Arctic, our ministry, the Ministry for Economic Development, together with our colleagues from the federal and regional authorities and organizations, prepared a so-called portfolio of the project which are currently being implemented or are being planned to be implemented in the Arctic area. We chose about 150 priority projects with the duration of up to 2030 with an overall value of almost 5 trillion euros, while the majority of funds, about 4 trillion, they come from the non-budget sources. And I shall emphasize, these are not only the projects which are currently being worked on, but also the ones that are just passing through the planning stage. Based on the need to create the backbone of the social and economic development of the Russian Arctic zone around these clusters of economic development, during the preparement of the government draft program for the development of the Arctic, the ministers were asked to identify these cluster zones of development, which envisages the development of the Arctic zone as wholesome projects through harmonizing all of the sectoral activities during the design and planning stages, setting the tasks and the goals and subsequent execution. I will later on touch upon the projects in detail. So we're talking about a certain social contract between the government and the business when the public undertakes efforts to eliminate infrastructural barriers or providing preferential treatment while businesses take a commitment to invest. This concentration of efforts on the part of all of the players in the Arctic, the federal authorities, regional government, businesses, and academia, would enable one to substantially optimize fiscal spending. Every project which is being implemented is not about to build the necessary infrastructure it requires or ask the government to do it, but you know, is taken into account along with the needs from all of the players, as well as being optimally aligned with the current existing project, so that makes the complementation possible. Apart from it, the Arctic development also envisages the possibilities to effectively apply the currently existing instruments in the government support area, which raises the investment attraction wherever it is appropriate, of course, such as free ports, industrial parks, special investment contracts, free economic zones, depending upon the terms of the project. It is important to understand that the cluster areas is not something new in terms of the tax exemption, but a well-thought-out approach to the development of the territory through the implementation of the projects which create the foundations for the social and economic development of the Arctic zone of Russia. So, along with this proposed approach and taking into account the competence that the Ministry of the Economic Development has in the area of strategic and territorial development, the Ministry here is going to act as the project office for the development of the Arctic. Comprehensive effect in implementation of these projects will be achieved through mutual stimulating effect in developing the Arctic transportation system aimed at the northern marine route and the industrial facilities in the area of development and production of natural resources. In this way, the creation of and the development of the industrial facilities will create the source to load up the transportation system, whose upgrading will facilitate the elimination of the infrastructural gaps. The implementation of the Arctic project creates the demand for personnel, technology and equipment for the Arctic needs. It is common to believe that Arctic in the first place is the place where you produce mineral resources without taking into account that the potential within such projects may become for the current Russia's scientific agenda as significant as used to be the space in 1960s. Russia faces the task of technological development and import substitution, and so in this sense the Arctic must become a testing ground for the new domestic innovative technologies who would be commissioned both by the government as well as the big businesses. Well, these could be the projects to produce new materials and new fuels which can be used in the extreme low temperatures, as well as the new transportation solutions, exploration equipment. Obviously, when working on a project in the Arctic, you should not forget about using the international cooperation, both with the Arctic states as well as with the non-Arctic players who are interested in utilizing the transit and resource potential of the Russian Arctic zone. Already now, I mean, businessmen from China, South Korea, Japan are voicing their interest towards that. The coordinating role in promoting international cooperation in the Arctic is with the Arctic Council, which is the framework for almost 80 projects currently being done. But we believe it is necessary to undertake measures to intensify this effort, because at present the projects are being worked on in the first place in the area of environmental protection and protecting the rights of the indigenous people, whereby we propose to expand this agenda by writing into it economic, social, industrial projects, so it will be worthwhile for us to produce the mechanism for selecting such mechanism and ensuring the funding required for them, including at the government level. And the last thing, to develop the Arctic, the fundamental is the existence of a respectively prepared individual. Because whether we have skilled labor or not, the success of any construction will depend and subsequently continuous functioning of all of the facilities. The Russian Arctic is the territory where you have 2.3 million people, so more than half of the population of the Arctic. These are big cities and big ports located along the North Marine Route, industrial centers. And so I would say that Russia has accumulated centuries of experience of how to set up and develop the necessary human environment. So there are things that we can be proud of, that we can share out with, and things that we could teach our foreign colleagues and partners. Taking into account the attention that the government is paying to the issues of social and economic development of the Arctic, as well as the strategic significance of the Arctic region in the intergovernmental relations, it is necessary to develop a constructive and multilateral dialogue dedicated to the Arctic amongst all of the interested parties, while raising the level of activities in the international organizations in the Arctic would help us produce a proper image of Russia as the key Arctic player, as well as to promote the mutually beneficial agenda for all of the countries in the region. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And here you can see in detail the projects and the necessary funding required for that. Thank you very much, Dmitry Olegovich.
Now, moving from the federal to the regional level, in extension of this topic, I would like to give the microphone to the deputy chairman of the government of Krasnoyarsk region, Yury ZAKHARINSKY, and he will tell us about the way this task of the cluster areas and the economic development is viewed from the level of the region, one of the biggest Russia's region and one of the biggest Arctic Russian regions. Thank you. Thank you, Andrey Konstantinovich. Dear colleagues, good evening to all of the conference attendees. Once again, I would like to offer my thanks to the organizers for the possibility to present the Krasnoyarsk region, for the possibility to present the projects for the development of the Krasnoyarsk Arctic. I have been participating in different foreign conferences during the past 2 years, and so it is for the first time when we decided to present the project for the development of the Krasnoyarsk Arctic. I had a presentation, but the example of one of the previous speakers inspired me, so I believe that I would do without it. The Krasnoyarsk region, indeed, is one of the biggest Russian regions, second biggest after Yakutia. It's more than 2.4 million square meters, 2,666,000 people. We have the wealth of the natural resources as well as in the Arctic North, and a great experience in developing, which is difficult to underestimate in terms of the Russia's strategic interest. So speaking about the Russia's strategy 2030, myself, as all of the participants of the conference, believe that the future of the country will be defined specifically by the development of the Arctic. 89% of the territory of the regions are the remote north areas and the adjacent ones, where you have about 500,000 people living, and three municipal districts in our region received the status of the Arctic zone, and specifically this is the city of Norilsk, the Taimyr, Yelanetsky, and Turhansky districts, which makes about 46% of the territory of the Krasnoyarsk region. The north of the Krasnoyarsk region is being developed very intensively, because today in the area of the Krasnoyarsk north, there are such flagships of the Russian industries as the Norilsk Nickel Mining Company, Rosneft Oil Producing Company, and so these businesses in many ways define the way of the development of the Krasnoyarsk region as well as the whole of the Russia. In the Norilsk industrial area, which includes the cities of Norilsk, Talnach, Karkan, the Snezhnogorsk township has about 180,000 people living in them. At the polar office of the Norilsk Nickel, which is city development center, there are about 3,000 people, and today this company plans to ship about 562,000 tons, both copper, nickel, platinoids, gold, silver, so altogether 15 elements from the Mendeleev table. And so Norilsk rightfully is believed in Krasnoyarsk to be the metallurgical capital of the region. Last year, the company paid into the budget of all the levels about 80 billion rubles. In taxes and levies, 42.4 billion rubles of taxes remained in the region, having formed up quite a significant part of the budget of the Krasnoyarsk region. In Krasnoyarsk Arctic, we are dealing with various environmental tasks, and the polar affiliate of the Norilsk Nickel is running various investment projects to upgrade the old production facilities. At the Nadezhdinsky factory, there is an upgrading and renovation which would be completed in Q4 2016, and the project calls for the increase of the production capacity, the processing of the concentrates of the copper and nickel ores from 1.9 to 2.4 million tons a year. Apart from that, the company would increase its capacity at the Talnach enrichment plant by 2015. The first stage was commissioned. The second stage was completed in the second quarter 2016. And by 2019, we are planning to implement the third stage of the plant. The capacity of processing wealthy copper ores will grow double as opposed to the current one, up to 20 million tons. The overall amount of investments of the company to upgrade this particular factory will amount to about 75 billion rubles. While the resolution of the better enrichment, we also resolve various environmental projects and issues overall in the Norilsk region and in Krasnoyarsk. In September 2016, we produced a full decommissioning of the old nickel producing equipment, and the overall capacity for the production of output in the Norilsk group were maintained through upgrading and expanding the state of the art equipment. As a result of this, in the Norilsk industrial park, 600 sources of pollution were eliminated, the environmental situation in the city has considerably improved. In the district of Turukhan, we have Vancouver Neft developing oil, which is the affiliate of the Rosneft company. The original recoverable reserves of the Vancouver field amount to 500 million tons of oil and condensate, 172 billion cubic meters of gas. Let me remind the participants of the conference that Vancouver Neft is an international oil company. 23.3% belong to the consortium of the Indian companies. To transport oil, and Vankor-Purpe oil pipeline was built, extending for 578 kilometers, out of which 108 kilometers pass through the territory of the Turukhan districts, the throughput having 25 million tons a year. Oil comes into the Vankor-Purpe pipeline and then into the Transneft system. During the past 10 years, we have built various production facilities and the treatment facilities. We have created the infrastructure for the social purposes. Since 2014, the company started implementing the gas program in the Vancouver, including the industrial supplies of, including the industrial shipment of gas into the gas transportation system of Gazprom. Also, the trunk pipeline Vancouver-Harme-Paiutinskaya field was built. Thanks to the plant technologies, the recovery ratio in Vancouver is one of the highest in Russia. The implementation of the project for the development of Vancouver since 2014 reached the peak of production, and then the reserves of the oil will be depleting and will reach the level of production at the level of 22 million tons a year, and will be maintained by introducing into operation new fields in the Suzun, Tagul, and Lodochne fields. We also prepared for the commissioning of operation the Suzun field with a capacity of 4.5 million tons a year. More than 60 production wells have been drilled. The field pipeline Suzun Vankor was built with extension of 173 kilometers with a throughput of 5 million tons a year. Towards the end of 2016, we are planning to start the development of two other fields, which is Tagul and Lodochne. Joining of these fields will enable to increase the annual output from Vankor up to 25 million tons of oil by 2019. And before 2025, the company is planning to totally invest 3 billion rubles, which will be aimed at the cluster itself, as well at the Srednye Batubinske and Yurchino Tahomske fields. By that time, the overall output throughout all of the fields in the district will be expected at over 55 million tons a year. We understand how weakly well explored the wealth of the natural resource in the Arctic. Utilizing unique northern fields, one requires a substantial increase of the exploration activities. In the Arctic zone, there are concentrated major reserves of the coal, platinum, oil, diamonds, and gold. And this whole unique mineral resource base may become the locomotive for the development of the Arctic and the country in general. So conducting new exploration effort, investing money into the development of the infrastructure and effective resolution of the tasks to ensure safety and security may turn our north into the source of growing Russian economic potential. So today, in the presentation by Dmitry Rogozin, we heard a figure of 150 projects which have been selected and were included into the portfolio of projects developing the Arctic. 48% of them for the production of mineral resources and 7% for the exploration work, etc. So this list of projects also includes the project in the Krasnoyarsk region. In 2014, Norilsk Industrial Park had a new company come in, Russian Platinum. Currently, this company is undertaking exploration work as part of the investment project being done of the development of the Chernogorsk deposit in the southern part of the Norilsk 1 field. In 2015, Lukoil in the Western Siberia, which is the subsidiary of public company Lukoil, also won the tender to develop the East Aymir field with the space of 3,800 square kilometers located in the western part of the Krasnoyarsk area. The expected resources, 4.5 million tons of oil, 9.3 billion cubic meters of gas, gas condensate, 500,000 tons. This year, exploration work is being undertaken. In 2017, there is a plan to drill two exploration wells. Very interesting fact that I would like to mention is that, in as far as the government of the Krasnoyarsk region is concerned, all of the resource developers and specifically including Lukoil, are entering into an agreement on cooperation already during the period of running the exploration work itself. And specifically, Lukoil West Siberia concluded an agreement to finance for 3 years 350 million rubles worth, including the construction of the school for 250 people and the construction of the sports facility and various offices for pastime of local people. In 2016, the RN Shelf Arctic, which is the subsidiary of Rosneft, is doing some work in the licensed acreage called Hatingi in Taimir. That includes preparation for drilling and exploration in the central Olgino, also drilling the structural parametric wells at the Haratus Peninsula, as well as doing some field development in the Hatinskaya Bay and at Haratumus Peninsula. The seismic acquisition is currently being completed in the Hatinskaya Bay. The planned start for the exploration drilling is June 2017. In 2015, in the Taimir in Galganyansk Municipal District, Vostok Ugol, the coal company, started, and its subsidiary, the Arctic Mining Company, which already started implementing the project to develop one of the biggest global anthracite deposit located in the Taimir coal basin with a space of about 70,000 square kilometers. Yury Nikolaevich, yes, I'm about to finish. Yes, very quickly. So, Vostok Ugol company received the right to study the exploration with the overall space of 5,000 square kilometers over 50 license acres. I simply want to say that today Rosatom was showing us a slide, and in the list of the Arctic project we saw Chaika port with a cargo throughput of 10 million tons, which specifically shows that this is the project which we believe the point of growth, both for the Taimir, for the Krasnoyarsk region, as well as for the Russian Federation. And already by way of a conclusion, whenever we talk about the Arctic, whenever we talk about the transportation system in the territory, which is supposed to support this accelerated development of the Arctic, I am very happy to have heard in Dmitry Rogozin's presentation saying words about the transportation access and the aviation support for the development of the Arctic territories. He mentioned the date of 2019 and the appearance of new aircraft, new equipment, because specifically, in as far as the Krasnoyarsk region is concerned, we are seeing it as one of the most acute problems, because we still fly AN 3426, already flying for, you know, like 40 years. And in conclusion, the previous speaker mentioned the creation of the cluster zones. In the list, we have 8 such centers: Taimir, Turuhan. Why? I guess it's quite obvious. I mean, I'm taking my time, but clearly, an existence of enormous resources, both in terms of copper, hydrocarbons, nickel, and brown coal, specifically, you know, determines the future for the development of this Taimir-Turuhan industrial cluster. And in conclusion, I would like to say that once again, the development of the Krasnoyarsk Arctic is where we see the development of the oil and gas complex, increase of the production and transportation of the hydrocarbons, organization of local centers for processing and treatment of oil and gas, and naturally, the production and development of the deposit of the coking coals, and then transporting this coking coal into Europe. So once again, thank you very much for the opportunity to introduce this project in the Krasnoyarsk area. I guess that I should learn to present in a shorter format, because for 2 years speaking a different forum, I always used to say that the government needs to adjust its approaches in the development of the Arctic. And so I have this feeling, you know, after 2 days and listening to all the sessions that I attended throughout this conference, that somehow the government is already adjusting its approaches in developing the Arctic. The attitude towards the problems and towards the regional concern is changing. Yuri Nikolaevich, I ask you to... Yes, and I would like to apologize, because, you know, the reason I asked the moderator to give me an opportunity to speak sooner than the skill, because I'm supposed to fly back to Norwich. So with, you know, apologies, I'm going to stop my participation, and then I will have to, you know, be on my way to the airport. Thank you very much. I'm sorry. Thank you very much, Yuri Nikolaevich, for such an interesting and exhaustive picture of the life of one of the biggest Russian regions. Thank you very much indeed, a very interesting presentation. Now I would like to give the microphone, going back to the federal level again. We have been joined by Roman Skory, who is a deputy head of the federal agency
for tourism of the Russian Federation, and so he will be telling us about the future possibilities in developing, you know, tourism, because this particular sector is not traditional for the North. This is the sector that a lot of hopes we have. Please. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Thank you very much for the opportunity to
Speak at the conference, and may I congratulate you all with opening of this forum. On my behalf personally, and also on behalf of the Agency for Tourism, I have a pretty long report for about 15 minutes, about judging by the presentation of the previous speaker. I think we should avoid situation. The main task of the state tourism, well, development of internal tourism, domestic tourism, and I think that's a huge perspective. Through all the world, we have great claims for extreme tourism, for expedition tourism. We had turned these abbreviations to experimental tourism, extreme tourism, basically, so that people understand that, you know, it takes a lot of preparation, training, and a lot of organizations were involved in this project. Well, Russian Geographic Society and Mr. Schengraf is playing a very active role promoting and developing this new direction, new line of expeditionary tourism. What I'd like to say, non-marine route is it's just a thoroughfare, marine thoroughfare, which contains huge potential, but not only as a connecting route of our northern ports, but also from the perspective of development of very big flow of tourists, which may come from abroad also, can be generated domestically, because all the points and territories in the Russian Federation, the upper north, are interesting in terms of from the touristic perspective, especially if proper communications on the waterways will be built out and developed, then only not by icebreakers, then these routes can be used as a touristic mecca. And today we had already organized our largest and biggest icebreaker, nuclear icebreaker, Futures Anniversary of the Victory. Well, we have a lot of applications. The price for the ticket is pretty high, just for one visit to the North Pole, up to $30,000. Nevertheless, we have already lots of applications, lots of requests, and we see here great potential, very promising potential, because we see definitely growing interest of such, you know, extreme places. Our high north, well, example can be brought, well, in case of Spitsbergen, you know, we've been present there for quite a long while. Initially, that was coal mining, but now our neighbors in Spitsbergen, Norway, are actively exploiting this topic and actively attracting, inviting to their territory, especially, well, tourists from the rest of the world. Well, last year it was 2,500 people, and people who stayed there overnight exceeded 44,000 tourists. Well, huge potential, because pricing policy here is very, very high, and that's really very interesting new development. Currently, well, there are over 3,000 bears now inhibiting Spitsbergen, and the chance to look at this, you know, host of the Nordic territories, of great interest for Russians as for all other people, you know, great of applications coming to our part of Russian control Spitsbergen. But today we're not prepared to provide services necessary for a proper service on level international. We don't have a proper class of hotels, so basically accommodation is a problem. We have other problems with supporting elements for the touristic infrastructure. Now we're speaking about active development of the Nordic territories, including, you know, defense capabilities, and at the Isle of Alexander, building of a new airport, and we are suggesting to build it for the airport of dual purpose, dual application, not only military but also civil, because such practices exist in the rest of the world, practically everywhere, you know, there's cooperation between, you know, defense installations and civil aviation, you know, services, which enables later to have a very good proceeds for the federal budget from the place where it's located. Well, Hurghada can be a good example. When they started building the airport, initially it was built as an Air Force airfield, but then it was also turned into a civil airfield, and now we have a very good synergy effect. Well, now just enjoyed by the Egypt. And so all the best experience from abroad should be actively applied in our territories, those enables to make a big quality leap. And here it will lead not only just increase in the tourist flow, but also positioning the country in the world globe, and also people diplomacy factor, because the more people from abroad will come over to our country, see our character, our openness, our hospitality, well, that all helped to improve the international climate. Only last year, according to independent, you know, estimates, we had received over 30,000, well, about 30 million. Well, according to the WTA assessment, that's that category exceeds 70 million people. So, and there are huge amount of requests coming just for the trips to our extreme north, and the Arctic is a magnet of a kind, because definitely the largest land territory adjoining northern pole, is the Russian north, Russian non-territory, and here the task is to develop infrastructural projects, but that includes Arkhangel, Murmansk, Karelia as well. Now we're reviewing, well, just the possibility of constructing a port in Republic of Karelia, but again, it's again reviewing it as in terms of, you know, possibility as economic hub, but nobody is looking at this, you know, prospect from the touristic point of view. But when we have you know, serious flow of application for tours there, and then turning this port into able to receive and serve tourist boats, well, of course, that will really enhance, you know, the tourist potential and the tourist flow in the region. Thank you very much. If there are questions, I'm more than eager to receive them and try. Well, and particular thanks for reminding notion of Spitsbergen. My labor biography started on Spitsbergen, and 16 years, well, in 2006, after visiting this archipelago, well, I saw really how well, you know, had developed, you know, the one of the settlements there, thanks to development of tourism. And that's a very good, just as a private initiative coming from grassroots and the combination will with a well-thought government policy, which really helped to raise this kind of deprived area. And definitely, well, it leads to development of international contacts, which so much were so much spoken and mentioned at this conference. Since we already made the reference notion of northern neighbors, I think it's high time to give floor to the representative of Finland.
Mr. RAUTAJOKI, you have the floor. Please give us your view on these issues. Olkaa hyvä, Timo.
Kiitos. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And first of all, it's a great pleasure for me to be here today and have my presentation here. So thank you for the invitation. The theme of United States chairmanship in the Arctic Council is One Arctic, and that's a good theme, but only on symbolic and philosophic level, because the region I'm now talking about is totally different. Mr. Nikolaev, the former president of the Republic of Saha, already mentioned that the northern parts of Scandinavia are different compared with the other part of the Arctic region, and that's true also in business. It's very typical for our regions, that means northern Norway, northern Sweden, and northern Finland, that we are industrial, we have the best available technology, high technology, we are innovative, we have quite good transport connections. And we have a strong export industry. For instance, my region, Lapland, is number four in Finland of the export regions. Our export is totally about 4 billion euros per year, and that's almost 10% of the total export of Finland. We are very famous of Santa Claus and tourism, and that's very good, and it's continuing and becoming stronger, but it's also industrial. Norbotten, Sweden is about the same. Then we have, of course, these big industrial companies, also SMEs. and we have entrepreneurs, so it's at every level of business we have activity, and we have also a European Union inner market in between Lapland and Norrbotten, Sweden, and it's working. It took about 20 years, and now we have business, cross-border business. It's a very good thing. With Northern Norway, we have this EEA, but so far, it's not happened so big breakthrough than that with between Finland and Sweden. East-west business is not typical for this region. It's south-north. That still today is the main direction. Also, transport connections are the same from south to north, and not so much from east to west, and that's today obstacle of trade. And when we take to this combination of regions, that's known also as North Kalot. We take from northern part of northwest Russia, Murmansk region, and Arkhangelsk. They are also industrial regions, and we get a very interesting business area. It's Norwegian term to call it European High North, and I think that's quite good name for this region, and which has quite big economical potential. It's all based on natural resources. Forest industry, metal industry, mining industry, and all these are sustainable, and also tourism. And these are tourism is also based on natural resources of nature and experience in the nature. Business is diverse. That's very important. We have big areas, so all branches of business should be able to do business without disturbing each other. And today we have conversation, dialogue, and even fighting about the mining industry and tourism. Can they be together in the same region? In my opinion, we can do that all. And also reindeer herding is a branch of business in Lapland, and there must be room for reindeer herding also. Investment potential of this European High North is huge. Lapland Chamber of Commerce has evaluated about 10 years the business potential. First to tell the Finnish government that heads up, something is happening in the High North, and we have been doing well. They have heard of our message. We have Arctic strategy and actions are totally different today compared with the time of about 10 years ago. According to our last evaluation, the business investment potential of this region is about 200 billion euros. That means that there are projects, we can find projects that have some kind of estimation of costs, and some kind of timetable is that big, and that's a huge sum of money. Biggest region is of course Northern Norway. They have very many oil and gas projects. Northern Sweden is they have 75 billion euros. They have even more that we could not see that they were ready projects. Northern Sweden 35 billion. Northern Finland 46 billion euros, and northwest Russia, the northern part, 38 billion. So there is a huge potential. Oil and gas is of course number one, but then there are also renewables like wind energy, transport infrastructure projects are also big, and I am happy that tourism projects are also more than 5 billion euros. So what happens next? We also tried to estimate the next 5 years, but it's difficult. We already heard that Mr. Chairman told about that it's different time now. The raw material prices are low, oil prices are low, and we have also some other obstacles. But we could find investment projects total value of almost 50 billion euros. So it still could be possible. But what happens next? In the northern Norway, they still talk about that oil and gas. Johan Castberg oil field is profitable because the new technology is profitable with the oil prices of $50 per barrel. So let's see what happens. They have also transport infrastructure projects. Northern Sweden, they decided to start to build new railway between Umeå and Luleå. It's more than 3 billion. And also Luleå port investment is big one. The mining investments are going to be ready very soon, but after that it seems to be that they still invest in the north in Sweden. In Finland, we have also project. Biggest is in Oulu region, south from Lapland. It's the Pyhäjoki nuclear power plant project of Fennovoima and also together with the Russian Rosatom. It's going to be 8 billion euros at least, and that is a huge importance also for our region. Then we have Chinese company Kaidi New Energy Group is planning and they promised to announce within a couple of months to start implementation of biofuel plant in southern part of Lapland to Kemi near the existing forest industry. Total value of this is 1 billion euros. So Chinese investors are in Lapland. Also tourism investments. It looks like the Chinese tourists from Asia, they are coming and our tourism is growing all the time and we get new flight connection, direct flights from London and from Munich and big companies like Lufthansa, they are opening new routes to Lapland. And that's we need the hotel investments and we have evaluated that within next 5 years tourism investments in Lapland are 1 billion euro also. Northwest Russia, we have noticed that Novatek has been is active in Murmansk, the building shipyard there, and it there's a lot of interest from Finland also there. But I think that for our region and Murmansk region, the mining projects in Murmansk region are the base of continuing business cooperation. To conclusion, I think that there are three things that we should remember. First of all, we have organizations like Chambers of Commerce cooperation with the North Chamber of Commerce and Industry in Murmansk. We have had more than 25 years, and also with Arkhangelsk Chamber of Commerce and Industry more than 20 years. So we have been doing that work, and we want to continue in spite of what is happening in the politics and so on. But it's important that we get our regional SMEs involved to these giant projects. That's the number one. That's why we are working. And then it's good possibility today to increase economic cooperation between Lapland and Murmansk region, and also between Finland and Russia in mining industry cooperation. We have mining projects also in Lapland, and there is only a couple of hundred kilometers from us, also in the Kola Peninsula. So we could have cooperation to get the new technology, best available technology to there. And after 1 month, there is going to be once again a big mining conference in Kirovsk. Our chamber is taking 10 companies from Finland to participate to this because we all the time we have had cooperation. Our companies from it's not only from Lapland, it's from whole Finland. They have had business there. And then Timo, I think that we should look at also this Novatek project in Finland. Mr. Chairman, I think that we did at the same time notice that the time is up. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Kiitos for really astonishing report on the prospects up north in Finland. Наши следующие два выступления будут посвящены уже не
presentation will be dedicated not to land-based, but the marine aquatic Arctic territories and the prospect for development. Just returning back a little bit to the previous discussion we had at the previous session, I'd like to give the floor to Mr. BOGOYAVLENSKY, a corresponding member of the Russian Academy of Science and deputy director the Institute for Oil and Gas Problems under Russian Academy of Science as well. On my behalf, I want to say he has great experience of, you know, expedition in the Arctic. We oil people know him very well as a high professional and also as a person who brings a good share of skepticism in our bright, you know, accolative, you know, approaches. Well, as you may see, the title I wouldn't reiterate and keep it. We'll try to get in gear and move a little faster. So last year we completed the analysis of the volume of oil and gas extraction in all countries of the Arctic region, while Russia was the pioneer in exploration production of hydrocarbons by Russia. By red, you see the share of Russia. By green on the top, it's what coming from Alaska, and practically we see no share of Norway and Canada. Otherwise, Russia's share is already exceeding 87% against the total volume of explored and extracted hydrocarbons. Well, comparing with other countries or their production in the Arctic zone, this is much more than all the total produced in the Mexican Gulf or everything extracted from the bottom of the North Sea. And for a long time, it was exceeding all, you know, production volumes in the recent years from the Persian Gulf. But may I repeat, there we have accumulated results of 10 countries. Here is just one country. If we're talking about Arctic as a whole, well, we see great difference. You see temperature lines, well, in mid-January, you see even in mid-January temperatures around zero. So here it's possible to apply standard technologies designed developed for Northern Sea and even for the Gulf of Mexico. But dark blue colors, that's real Arctic, where temperatures in January go down below 30 or even 40 Celsius. And here you cannot use standard technologies. Here you need new specific technologies, and of course it's much harder to work because of the icing situation, ice clad and perennial ices. This year we didn't set up any years. The minimal square, ice square, was back in 2012. This year the situation more or less same as last year, although everybody thought that the ice covered space was seriously shrinking. Well, seismic density is different, but where you see most profiles is the most prosperous area, at least at the current level of knowledge, geological knowledge. And after many years of work, we made the map where we analyze the potential of all basins in the Arctic region with deep intake into the land territory, because geology knows no frontiers and limits. When you study the sea bottom, you need also to look into the land situation. And you see that the most abundant and brightest colors on this map are happen to be in the Russian segment of the Arctic, both marine and land. By black dots, you see the already drilled wells. You see they're all grouped in several zones, and in pink and green colors, we show the basins with prevailing reserves of gas or oil. Oil is shown by green color. So as a result of almost 50 years of surveys on the Canadian shelf, the record number of deposits had been discovered, 42 of them. In Norway also about 40 deposits, of which only 10 are more or less profitable in terms of exploration. That's why we're showing only 10 on the Norwegian sector, which is also a source of great joy for them. In Russia, the 23 discovered fields, but now, so far, it's a big question how many of them are really rentable. And in Alaska lately, we heard, you know, announcement of another one, even huge in Western terms, natural deposit, well, comparable to Prilozlovne, even bigger than Prilozlovne. The technologies applied for exploration are shown on the slide. Americans are working exclusively from the Isles. Our Prilozlovne platform is basically an artificial island at Belesneshka, Snowmate. It's the submarine complex that's in Norway. And starting from this year, they start exploring oil from the marine platform, which we'll see a bit later. We observe overall growth of volumes of drilling in the Arctic, although in some areas it's reducing, but overall we see the growing climbing strange. And if we look at the two neighboring countries, Norway and Russia, also illustrated by diagrams, you see in the recent years, Norwegians were the most active in this respect, mainly due to the fact because their equatoria is more comfortable, if it's a proper term, rather than all other aquatic territories. And due to the geological survey projects, we try to compare the reserves, who's bigger, Russia or Norway, but when I made this kind of circle diagrams, and the blue section is the Norwegian share, which was really big, you know, upset for the Norwegians. They were really very upset. And now in Krugavaya we built this floating platform, and also Belesneshka deposit is really having, you know, shivering, having going through a rash. We spoke with our moderator, and yeah, the territory around there, Melkoi became the most polluted in the Arctic. Well, the Russian, the Arctic territory is very complex and diverse in geological. Now we observe very dynamic development of several hubs like Yamal and Yamal LNG project, and also in the estuaries of the rivers. Well, Balanyankovska deposit demonstrates brilliant results. So in one of the diagrams we see brief history of drilling, and as a result of brilliant, perfect work of Gazprom, they got increased their reserves by 1.5 million cubic meters, and they also set up the minimal cost of the reserve yield, well, many times cheaper at the than adjoining land. And this is not production, it's just the proved reserves increase. But I continue to state that the marine exploration may be much more profitable and rentable than land development, not up to $100 per barrel, as Mr. Bandanchik was stating times ago. Well, as we see, unfortunately, well, we have certain, you know, cooling in the international cooperation, although overall everybody's speaking about warming in the Arctic. Everything you see here in red and pink colors refers to Russia, and if in the oil we have 40%, then in gas, well, 91% of all proved gas reserves belong to Russia. Otherwise, Russia is undisputed leaders. We also analyzed production from marine deposits, as you may see in Alaska. Well, marine deposits were started exploring much earlier in green color, shown Alaska, Norway shown in blue and red color. This big flight of our marine production mainly coming from Milhar deposit, which is developed by the horizontal inclined wells drilled from the shore, but same technologies are used by the Americans, even starting drilling from the shore, from the coast. Just 1 minute more, please. It would be probably wrong for me to present everything in this kind of bright and beautiful color. In case of Russia, there's a lot of problems we have to overcome. I'm not going to read what's written there on the slide. It goes without saying that Arctic is the most difficult region both for humans' life and also for exploration and production of oil and gas. Well, lately, in the recent years, we've been quite often flying to field expedition, Bailey Isle and Yamal well, checking historically drilled wells, and we often come across a well-known phenomenon, which is called, you know, vortexes or craters of Yamal. But the most meaningful line for explorations and surveys and for taking some measures, it's a big scale technique, again, you know, leakage of hydrocarbons along the drilled column. And this is the source of tremendous damage and harm for ecosystem. We had discovered over 150 artificial lakes like this. These are craters of gaseous outbursts, and sometimes they're also getting inflamed. And you see this most famous crater, well, which was detected back in 2014 when it was formed. We had organized several expeditions to this crater and to other ones. You see, you can put a big skyscraper into this crater. So some people went down there in the night time. It was November, polar night. So the first person in the world who came into the creator of gas outbursts, Vladimir Pushkarev, also in his capacity as director of the Russian Institute for Exploration of Arctic. 2 weeks ago, we had to fire him from the board because he was elected as the deputy to the State Duma, to the Russian Parliament. And I really was amazed what a fantastic, colossal results had been achieved in the last 2 or 3 years in the Russian Center for Development of the Arctic. Well, it was set up according to the decree of President Putin, so it had to work well. And concluding my presentation, I want just to recite what's written here in our declarative documents: Russia is open for international scientific and business cooperation. We invite them all to take part, and it's Vasily, thank you very much. As usual, your presentation was very well condensed and very fruitful and interesting. Well, our next speaker, Mr. ZILANOV, Vyacheslav Konstantinovich ZILANOV, in his current committee, well, chairman of the Nordic Coordination Council Association of Fishing Industry of the Nordic Basin, Sevryba, Norfish. Well, that's a Russian acronym, but I can't mention the fact that for many years he was deputy minister of the fisheries of the Russian Federation. So basically, he is the father of the documents which regulate our relations and fisheries with the adjoining states in the north. And he also had selected a very good topic for unlawful and regulated fishing practice, which was already mentioned in relation to the situation in the Central Arctic. So he is probably more knowledgeable on this topic than the majority of the Russians. Thank you very much indeed for such a flattering presentation and introduction. And naturally, fish is always a big interest for all of us, and not only in the situation when it's on the table or on the plates. Before, I'd like to express thanks to the chairman of the Nordic Council for International Affairs for permanent attention and care for us, practical workers, to whom I belong as well, may I say so, for permanent invitation to such higher-level meetings where we participate and always learn something important and new. Today, much was already said concerning certain aspects of fisheries and fishing. I want to emphasize that the living resources, biotic resources of Arctic seas, first of all, belonging to the five adjoining Arctic states, so they play great roles. There are different assessment evaluations of catches. If we include into the Arctic zone the seas which, according to their climatic status, belong to the Arctic basin, Sea of Bering, Sea of Ochotsk, and other, but the cat overall catch is about 20 million tons, evaluated at from 2 up to 3.5 million US dollars. Well, the fate of all indigenous people and permanent inhabitants of the coastal areas of five Arctic states depends and very much relies upon the status of these reserves and the way we use and utilize them. Well, naturally, fishing is being done on an industrial scale, primarily in northwestern segment of Arctic. And if we take the polar circle as a southern border, we see that dislocation of fishing fleets are situated and located and concentrated mainly in this area. But nevertheless, along the whole coastal line, along polar circle, Greenland, Faroe Islands, Iceland, Norway, Russia, United States, and other, well, explore and catch from 100 to 120,000 tons every year, with announcement of 200 territorial zones in this region of Arctic, we see certain enclaves which are surrounded from all sides by the special economic zones, so 2 to 3 states or even one zone. So far, there are 5 zones in the Arctic, calling from just a hole from the bagel, well, in between U.S. and Russia, in the Sea of Azov, you know, a rectangular spot. Also, there are some enclaves in the Sea of Norway and also another enclave in the Barents Sea, and the largest one attracting a lot of attention of surveyors, researchers, and even, with that to say, people dealing with geopolitics is the open part of the Arctic Sea. If we look at the disposition of these enclaves on the map, we must say that 4 of these 5 have the direct reliance of Russia, which is the only country in the northern hemisphere bordering all these enclaves. So, according to the UN Conventions on the Marine Law, it's possible to exercise fishing in this enclave for all countries, not only for the coastal countries, and definitely this opportunity had been used by, you know, fishermen from other countries. Well, unregulated fishing in this enclave was growing very fastly, thus inflicting a very serious damage to the reserves of the coastal states. The matter is, none of these enclaves have isolated reserves which would inhibit all year round, exclusively in this enclave, thus spending there the whole life cycle. But the fishing reserves, unlike us, law-obedient objects, they do not recognize borders, and they migrate crossing these legal conventional lines. And all these reserves, which were used with infringements and violations, as we call them, unregulated, unreported, illegal fishing practice. And please pay attention that at the most critical spot in the Sea of Bering, unregulated hatching was bringing from 800,000 tons up to 1.3 million tons, and our American friends already spoke about what a serious damage was inflicted, and that reserve hadn't been restored, and even up today. So, due to my professional role, I was involved in many negotiations concerning these matters, and this negotiated process had also was, you know, partaken by high diplomatic circles, and Mr. Ivanov, Sergeyevich, who is present as well, was also participating in these difficult negotiations with the United States concerning enclaves and the Sea of Bering. Well, the solution of this problem, we've been looking on the basis of bilateral, multilateral negotiations, mainly basing on two tools, primarily UN Convention on the Marilu, well, agreement on the fishing reserves and the solutions along the diplomatic channels and in practical sense was based on trust and measures of trust. Once there is trust among the states reviewing, talking about this enclave problem, the effect was immediately achieved. And that was utterly important. Once again, I want to emphasize that was really the key for solution to this problem. Well, convention agreements will pass through quickly. Well, the UN Convention provides, you know, toolkit both for specific regions and species, and definitely it's providing no basis for the principle of negotiating countries, because all the countries were participating in this convention and ratifying this convention with exclusion of the United States. But well, the agreements on trans-border reserves were signed and ratified as a result of bilateral and multilateral negotiation. We were able to come up to the agreements which are listed here in the Sea of Aquats. It's the bilateral intergovernment agreements for the Bering Sea, a special convention, UN Convention on Hydrocarbons, well, for protection of population of local species in the Greenland on the bilateral. But what to do about the central part of the Arctic Sea, where we have the largest enclave assessed at 2.8 million, over 5 million tons. But again, I want to say right away that elevation of ice in this area is a brilliant opportunity for illegal catching, but that's also a brilliant opportunity for scientific researchers, and also a brilliant opportunity for new negotiations and reaching new agreements which would stop and put on and halt this illegal production. But we heard a lot, why do you make such a big noise and about this situation? I want to disillusion those, well, which is very hard to counter. In the open space of polar cod is the place of the inhibitor. Well, and the migration of this species is well studied. And as you may see, they come from the ice territories, and they come just for delivering, you know, the cover well out of the ice territory. In the past, well, the catch was done on a big scale, 370,000 to 380,000 tons. Moreover, and well, it was done during the wartime because we needed some nutrition and protein, access to a new source of protein. How to stop it? Well, first, the declaration had been signed it's a binding document, and I agree with the lawyers who spoke here, and I agree this is a tool which has to be taken into account and complied with. Also now, well, a new agreement is in the works for protection of fishing reserves in the central part of Arctic Sea, and this process already had been attained by all five Arctic states and four non-Arctic states, and that is a very good field for achieving agreement in this area. And as a practitioner, I'm just calling the participant not to sit too long at the negotiation table. The document is there. It had to be approved and signed. And if there are any doubts concerning what's going to be there, I'm going to bring up another example of my country's practice. When we started developing and exploring the cold waters of Antarctic, we had only sketch. When we went there, we found different species of fish, different types of herring. I'm not mentioning krill. And also we discovered the reserves of illuminous anchovies. So I think with such approach, we'll have a lot of surprises in Arctic as well. So now we need to apply very energetic measures for adoption and the endorsement of this agreement. If we don't do it this way, then we leave the resource of Arctic to the tigers, who also like to come up on the ice and to eat fish.
Oh, tigers on an ice, very exotic scenario. Although the Arctic global experience shows that there's nothing impossible there. Thank you very much, Vyacheslav Konstantinovich. So our next speaker, Vladimir BAGREEV, who is the advisor of the Norwegian-Russian Chamber of Commerce in Russia, continuing on the topic of international cooperation, but switching over to the bilateral format. Vladimir will tell us about the work done by his Chamber of Commerce and as an example of what joint businesses can do. Well, but first of all, thank you very much, Igor Ivanov and his colleagues, for this excellent event and the possibility to participate and speak at it. A lot was said yesterday and today about the need to develop business cooperation between the business structures of our countries. So one of the instruments for such a cooperation are bilateral chambers of commerce. Ours was set up in 2003, and by that point in time there were 18 Norwegian organizations and two Russian ones who acted as the founders who worked in the The main purpose is to promote the Norwegian capital products and services into Russia and respectively the Russian capital products and services into Norway. And one of the basic problems which we see throughout these years, and we're trying to solve them, is to a large extent lack of knowledge amongst the Norwegian businesses of what is Russia and what is the Russian reality and how one can do business here, and vice versa, amongst the Russian businesses, the lack of knowledge of what Norway is all about and how one can do business there. Today, the Chamber unites about 140 members. This is not an impressive statistic for Russia, but we have some flagship companies such as Statoil, Telenor, and a whole host of others who are our members. On the Russian side, we have Neshekonom Bank, Lukoil overseas. So all in all, 60% of the Norwegian exports into Russia is represented by the chamber members, and about 80% of the imports from Norway is also represented by the chamber members. One should note that in order to overcome this lack of knowledge or somehow to assist the Norwegian and Russian businessmen to learn about each other's realities and the business practices, we are holding a number of events, and one of the main ones is what we describe as networking meetings, and these are the kind of gatherings of the members who we hold on a regular basis in the cities in Norway, in Archangel, Murmansk, in St. Petersburg, and sometimes in Moscow, where we provide the opportunity to the chamber members to discuss various vital and ununderstandable issues. But on the other hand, we allow them, and specifically to the new members, to describe what they are, what they can do, what they can contribute, and what are their expectation, what is their expectation from us. We also do big events, the one that described as the Norwegian-Russian Business Forum. The first of such Norwegian-Russian forums. I believe this is the biggest business event which traditionally takes place between Russia and Norway. It happened in 2010 during the official visit by the then Russian President Dmitry Medvedev. These fora became regular, and we hold them reciprocally in Norway and in Russia. On October 26th, there will be the fifth Norwegian-Russian forum, so you are very much welcome. This year, Russian companies will be participating in this forum for free. We also hold what one describes as a matchmaking project. This term is not a very successful one, but the idea behind it is good. As asked by the Russian companies in the territory of Norway, in the sector of industry, in a specific sector of industry, and in a specific region that the Russian customer is interested in, we find a direct partner and take them all the way to the negotiating table. And similarly, following the request we receive from a Norwegian company in the Russian region, in a specific area of Russia that is of reason, we do monitoring and hold preliminary negotiation, trying to identify companies who do a better match making complementation. So for about the last 3 years, we've been busy doing this work. And thanks to the Minister for Foreign Affairs of Norway, because it sponsors this project as well as a number of other projects we do for Russian companies. This costs only 45,000 rubles for Norwegian companies, considerably more. As of today, there are about 70 companies from Russia and Norway who were able to find each other thanks to this project. These are different industries, fisheries, oil and gas, travel and tourism, energy efficiency, and a whole number of others. Well, I should say that despite a certain difficult situation right now, the Chamber's work is being actively supported by the Ministry for Foreign Affairs of Norway, and it is funding a number of projects in the matchmaking program. We have a very interesting project aimed at the universities and the young generation businessmen. It is called Young Entrepreneurs to the Innovative Development. This project, which currently had almost 20 Russian and Norwegian universities participate, amongst them our famous Northern Federal University in Moscow. It's the financial university under the Russian government, the Gupking Oil and Gas University on the Norwegian side, Tromsø and Gouda universities, Oslo universities. As the result, the students on the one hand are able to gain knowledge about what business is all about, because in the course of such a project they have to prepare and design a project that usually some big Norwegian company is commissioning. So we prepared a business case for Statoil. We also prepared a business case by Kværner last year, actually. The Russian business case was being prepared by a local overseas company. And so at the outcome, we receive not a ready-made businessman ready to go into the international corporation, but an individual who had already felt the gist of the international corporation. the gist of what it means to work with a foreign partner. A whole number of projects we do to develop various areas that have been previously mentioned, like with the SOFON, we held a big project about the tourism into the area of Archangel. In Murmansk, similar project was organized for the purpose of increasing the number of incoming travelers by attracting them with the history of the Archangel district and the northern territories and the Solovki place history and a whole number of places of interest that one finds there. Well, the result still is to be expected, but nevertheless, the outlook in terms of what was already mentioned by the representative of the tourism agency, we hope is going to be a positive one. Well, honestly, just 1 minute left there, thank you. We work very closely with all of the structures that the Norwegian-Russian cooperation can encompass, including the Russian Trade Office in Norway and the Norwegian Trade Representation in Russia, the embassies, the Norwegian district chambers that you find in some of the cities, a whole network of universities, like I mentioned, are also chamber members. So it all helps us to very actively and relatively expediently deal with the requests we receive from our members. So this is our Norwegian-Russian Business Forum that I've mentioned before. So once again, you're welcome. If you can make it, we will be more than happy to see you. And I guess, well, clearly these are our sponsors who we wouldn't be so active in our work. Once again, I shall repeat, whenever you talk about the direct cooperation between a business structure between Russia and Norway, please pay attention to the Chamber of Commerce, this joint Chamber of Commerce, because that represents the kind of an instrument which makes it possible to bypass a whole number of reefs that you have as a barrier on the way of cooperation and, you know, achieve the solution that you have to achieve much more quickly. Thank you. Thank you very much, Vladimir Alexandrovich. And effectively, the example of the work done by the Norwegian-Russian Chamber shows that despite the political complications that we have between certain Arctic countries, not in the Arctic area itself, thank God, business is always targeting, you know, real interests and real benefits. And based on my own experience of dealing with the oil and gas equipment producers or services, I can note that the interest in developing this cooperation, even against sanctions, you know, remains. There are certain limitations indeed, but nevertheless, there's still a feeling that the companies, their longer-term planning, do hope that this cooperation one day will recover its pre-crisis levels and maybe even exceed it. Our next speaker, Valery Chishkanov, Deputy Chairman of the Council for the Study of the Productive Labor, Member Correspondent of the Russian Academy of Sciences, and he will be telling us about different national approaches to the development of the Northern Territories. Dear Igor Sergeyevich Ivanov, dear Andrey Konstantinovich, and dear colleagues, I would first of all like to express my deep appreciation and gratitude for the opportunity to be here and talk to you. And I would like to pass a hearty welcome from the SOPSA team, which we believe is actively working on the Arctic problems today. 20 years. Well, I think, and I always treat age as just a figure, but what's important is what is in it. And Igor Sergeyevich, I would always like to remember and refresh the memory of those present of 1996, very difficult year in this country,
where we were making our first steps to save the economy, we had our hands full with different problems. And at that point in time, the council was being established, the one which today celebrates 20th anniversary. I will be honest, I has always been believing, and I believe that wise are the people who can foresee things. And I always believed that the person who could see many years in advance was the Noah, who built the ark before the flood. And so I believe that we are not going to have the flood, but whatever we heard today indeed makes our task quite clear, and that is to develop the kind of system for the development of the Arctic so there wouldn't be any flood, big or small, but for life to prosper in it. Because indeed, I have a feeling that throughout this whole day we were able to talk about many issues, but the basic idea behind this conference is how to improve the efficiency of the work we do in the Arctic. The fact of the matter is that it is no secret, and you all know, I mean, amongst those who work in the Arctic, that the Arctic is one of the wealthiest corners of the world. I mean, I don't think it's the proper way to name it, but one of the wealthiest territories on Earth. And from the point of view of management, I would say that one of the most important tasks is what kind of mechanisms need to be put in place from the economic viewpoint, from the social viewpoint, from the legal viewpoint, from the political viewpoint, so as to truly engage all of this wealth to make it serve for the benefit of the people. And today, when Dmitry Rogozin was speaking, he told us about one of the mechanisms that can be used in the Arctic, and you know, this is the State Commission, which does gigantic amount of work and specifically manages the process related to the development of the social and economic policy for the development of the Arctic up till 2020 and for longer term. A working mechanism has been established which enables one to combine efforts between science, businesses and society to solve these challenges. The second idea in my mind, which was actively promoted from this stage, it's unifying the efforts of the Arctic nations based on the principles of mutual benefit and management. And here I would like to specifically note based on specialization and cooperation. Indeed, the experience that different nations have in developing the Arctic zone is huge. And I believe, Igor, that it is worthwhile thinking how to more expediently, not only to gather this experience, but to replicate it for all the countries who are interested, both from the point of view of the logistical, organizational mechanisms, economic, social, without mentioning the mechanisms of developing new technologies and science, because today the U.S. ambassador specifically mentioned that September 28 in the White House, one of the declarations was signed, which applies to the role of science in developing the Arctic. So it seems to me that the implementation of this particular approach should undoubtedly take into account the specialty of the region, which significantly enable us much more effectively with less cost to do what we can do. Second thing, it seems to me that truly today it is no secret that the most effective system of management is such which takes into account not as much as internal factors, but the external ones. But here we've got an interesting fact to deal with, that each country, which is one of the main players in the Arctic in terms of its relationship to itself, and in terms of both represents external and internal factor. And so we're talking about combining all of these efforts, I mean external and internal factors, because against the current trends of globalization, it is difficult to overestimate this particular factor. You know that recently in Mexico there was a typhoon. Now, where is it? Too far away? But we all felt it passing through Mexico because oil prices went up, and we immediately felt it. It was no accident when I heard that the representative of the Swiss Institute, the institute in Switzerland, which is studying the Arctic. It's a stunning thing, and I believe that these are non-active players, but the ones who can clearly understand what may happen if we don't combine our efforts with respect to various issues, particularly including the issues of regulating the resolution of various Arctic problems. The third idea, we believe, is a creative approach to resolving the Arctic issues. A lot already has been said, both in the presentation by Dmitry Rogozin, our vice premier. We also heard it from Dmitry Olegovich, who is deputy head of the Ministry for Economic Development. Yes, indeed, there are such mechanisms available, special economic zones and technological parks, industrial parks, and the cluster areas. But specifically, you know, dealing with the spatial development and specifically considering the Arctic, we see that not always the interests between the horizontal and vertical axis dovetail. This is a complex process that one has to overcome, because indeed many corporation which works there, it's very important for them for the pump to work, for everything to be so nice, and sometimes anything which relates to the social infrastructure is pushed towards the background. The leaders of the Russian regions face different kind of goals. How to combine it? It is difficult. This is really complicated. We're trying to, but I would say that Dmitry Olegovich is criticizing us in developing the concept of the clusters, but that, as we felt, represents one of the main problems. But the reason I'm talking about it, because from the point of view of the spatial development, every country with respect to the Arctic and generally, we are a single thing. And here, I believe one should also think about the common kind of the regulation mechanism which would enable to regulate these processes without touching upon, negatively touching upon the interests of other countries. And the fourth idea, without doubt, is, I would say, an establishment of the innovative educational center by the companies which work in the Arctic. I mean, the companies from all of the countries. So the first violin, so to say, in this initiative will be played by the people who live in the Arctic. And it is very important here specifically, I mean, to understand the problem of professional training that we spoke about yesterday and today, and of course, social infrastructure. In my mind, a very fruitful idea is developing legal acts for internal and external international application. A lot already has been done about it, but I would say that our legendary Arthur Chilingarov, who has been re-elected into the current Russian parliament from the point of view of our internal interest, he will indeed be standing by everything related today at the level of the federal legislation governing the development of the Arctic. But as life has shown, if there is a law and it is there, it won't work if there are no sub-legal act or enabling legislation, I would say, which would reflect the specificities of various countries, the specificity of different geographies. And so quite naturally, and the very same Arctic code that we heard about today, it seems to me, would be a good platform to combine efforts. And moreover, it seems to me that one would rather create something as a Mendeleev's table. The problem, as it is being dealt with in the legal space, economic, social, etc. And maybe, Igor Sergeyevich, I'm asking you again, by utilizing the possibilities of the Council to revisit this problem. Because it seems to me that if whatever has been mentioned here today and yesterday, and I believe a lot is going to be said about it, if all of it is done, then whatever you mentioned, that sun over there as the sign which represents the work done not only by your council, then it really doesn't matter whether it's the Arctic day or the Arctic night, then we won't have to build the kind of the ark which Noah built in his time. Thank you. A great many thanks.
Truly, yes. We shall overcome today together. Well, our conclusive and final presenter is Alexei Zhivikin, head of the projects of NOAA MPK record, whose presentation is very well connected with the previous report about scientific achievements, because we can hear about possible aid and help and support from our space industry to the Arctic project. I have the honor to be the last speaker, and also I'd like to join all the thanks and accolades, well, in the address of organizers, but my presentation will be related not only to the space achievement, also information, you know, provision of all the Arctic projects. Well, you see that in the plan of development of Arctic zone, there's a project of development of means and the centers for space services. I'll try to explain what it's all about. First of all, what are the results of our space activities? We have three main documents. Well, the basics of state policy and application use of the result of our space activity exploration for the period of up to year 2030, which was confirmed support back in 2014. Well, there's a decree of the government about the powers of the regional administrations in terms of use of the results of space exploration. And the main element is that Roscosmos playing the coordinating role in all this activity. And talking about terminology, so what is the result or results of space activities? Basically, that's all the information received on the Earth from the spaceships, and also the results of processing of this information expressed not only in the information product itself, but also in the means and systems for use and application of the system. Well, I wouldn't go on long, make long talk about, you know, advantages of use of remote information obtained from the space. Well, what's the purpose of implementation and traction of this technology? The overall goal is possibility of obtaining by all possible stakeholders, government, non-government, education, etc. Well, the quality and homogeneous information. Well, referring back to the complex of measures, what it represents. And here on the slide, you see the model of interaction between the responsible executioners and performers, well, Roscosmos and the governmental bodies. Two main theses: that for the federal budget, Roscosmos and the framework of implementing realization of appropriate targeted programs, well, is creating base technologies, standard solutions, and develops models for use and application of space information on the part of the region, on the level of the regional federal programs adopted in all Arctic regions, define the priorities and key applications. Well, defines the subject with plenipotentiary powers in the specific territory in the region, which may be not a separate, a single organization. It might be a center for transportation monitoring or highly precise positioning institution. Further, the region performs number of measures, and Roscosmos transfers the results of its intellectual activities into the practical operation for the purpose of development of the region. And further, I want to focus my attention on two main works, one which was completed, one is just in the phase of state, you know, tests. So what is the center of space services? This is the competence center which is responsible search, collection of different information, spatial information, or map information, well, remote sensing information, or even out of space, non-space data. And here we can't avoid international cooperation in this respect, because the Arctic conditions, polar night, and so on, well, call for very specific, you know, means of observation, which we do not have currently. Also, we're looking for really tailored solutions, finished solutions, complete solution. So, well, to compete with the Institute of Arctic in the area of monitoring of ice drifting, we simply cannot and wouldn't compete, because they do it on a regular basis. They have great system, perfect system, and their clients are either Hydromed or several organizations with whom they work on contractual basis. They're also interested in introduction development of such centers, and they're not the only ones. We have great information in our country. Unfortunately, most of it is unavailable and inaccessible. And even on the regional level, every agency, every department have their own databases. But they're not integrated, not put into complex pools, but only the complex pools will create new quality of information, thus enabling to substantially cut operating costs in the process of decision making. Besides information gathering, well, the center must have its own competence for processing of the data, and in this situation, Roscosmos has accumulated competences for creation of about 70 information products. We're talking here about the basic information products in the area of power engineering, water complex, monitoring of water resources, forestries, etc. It's pretty long list. No less importantly, another task of the Center of Space Services, the normal regulation providing and supporting activities with outside suppliers. Well, basically, this is the cross point of interagency cooperation within the region, and the system had been developed for bringing all information for different groups and categories of consumers, including mobile means, for providing all the necessary data. So such system has been developed already. It's finished in the Roscosmos. Now it's being implemented and introduced at the territories of two regions. And we do hope that in the new future, that in the regions, well, belonging to the Arctic zone, such system also will be realized. Another no less interesting system, which is now going through a phase of test, is the system of highly precise positioning. But the peculiarity is that we have created the system which twice cheaper in terms of its servicing costs. Otherwise, the system which assumes installation of base stations at the distance of 50 to 70 kilometers one from another. In this solution, you can position these stations at position with gaps of 100 to 120 kilometers from each other, which is especially important for hardly accessible territories. We base and found our projects on our geo-information platforms, our own proprietary development, which enables us gives a very good management of the systems to undertake analysis and also to integrate with external information sources. And this platform is part of the domestic Russian system of information system approved and endorsed by Ministry of Communications. So the platform will enable us to realize thematic and well, other sources. So in the center, we see this information resource for Arctic territories. We've been looking and thinking for long where to find financial support to whom we could offer the system. As a result, we found partners in the form of information agency of Russian Arctics, and we started accumulating data. Definitely, we need the feedback, and that's why we're inviting you all to visit this resource, and we'll be happy to hear your comments. Well, naturally, well, these products are not the limit of our interest. We are ready to provide scientific and technological support. We are ready to share with you our experience and technologies. We are prepared and ready and willing to realize new projects. And definitely, we're interested in joint realization of commercial and socially important projects. And in conclusion, I'd like to say the following. You know, currently, the industry is coming up to, you know, streamline production or saving production. And what's really important, it all begins with visualization. If you come to the production room and you don't know what's going on there, and if you look at the scheme and you simply cannot understand the technological process happening there, that means chaos. And we understand and believe that space information and geoinformation technologies, the tools, the means which really can help to apply very saving and streamlining attitude to protection of northern territories. Thank you very much indeed. Well, here we, it was our last speaker. I had a request for a short note from Vice President of the Union of Industrialist Entrepreneurs of Republic of Komi, Mr. Kozlov Vikentiy Alexandrovich. I cannot give you more than 2 minutes, but please, this time is yours. Well, thank you, Andrey Konstantinovich. Thank you for the invitation, which we received from you for partaking in this interesting conference. Thanks for Igor Sergeyevich for this invitation. And in this case, I represent the International Academy of Communications. And I'd like to say that development of Arctic, improvement of quality of life, including, you know, small indigenous people, and providing informative, you know, safety in Russia, is impossible without interconnected communication networks. Unfortunately, today we do not see systematic approach for development of communications in the Arctic zone. Every agency, every department, every ministry is developing communication according to its own needs and its own departmental complex. Unfortunately, we're lagging behind in this respect from the foreign countries, which are the members of the Arctic zone, because many of them are already laying down optical cables and networks which make the basic element for communication grids in different territories of the high north. I want to say that the International Academy of Communications and the National Academy of Transport at the round table joint session involving scholars and scientists well reviewed our positions and discussed possibilities for joint efforts and developments work in the Arctic. We'd like to apply our suggestion that in the final document you would also reflect on the problem of systematic development of communication means in the Arctic zone. Well, we have lots of materials. Unfortunately, I can't make a full report. We've been invited to participate in the conference, which is scheduled already, will take place in our country. So a great wish I want to express that this conference will include a specific section dedicated to the issue of development communication in the Arctic, because we see no further successful development in this zone without proper development of communication element. Thank you very much for raising very important issue. As an oilman, I can say that within our problems, with joint problems with Norwegian, one of the main hurdles and barriers in our joint project was just the lack of reliable communication systems and geopositioning systems. Very briefly, please. Please present yourself, introduce yourself. Sergey Borisovich, I cannot give you more than a minute. I'd like to direct your attention just to two aspects. Mikhail Vladimirovich was talking about the corridor between Yakutsk and Tiksi, and truly in the strategic documents for development of railroad transportation, we don't have such documents in this relation. I want to say if there's a need in such corridor, we need just feasibility study developed, which could show us possible, you know, cargo flows along this. Well, and we're talking about how compatible it can be with the Siberian Board. We need to assess possible effects and performances for all stakeholders, including, well, the adjoining territory in the region. And also we need to assess the costs. We need to make the cost assessment. And even if we agree with construction of such a railroad, I'd like to remind you that we don't have clear understanding about financing of such a. So far, we're trying for a long while to implement the northern latitude passage. Perhaps if we knew how to finance it properly, we'd build it a long time ago. And in this respect, I'd like to address your attention to Paul Bergman's, you know, phrase about the terms of boring, which could stretch for several dozen of years. But the issue of finance of structural projects should be worked upon in more detail and more thoroughly if we really want to implement them. Yeah. Thank you for your pretty precious comments. Unfortunately, well, the time of our session is coming to the end. I must tell you, frankly speaking, that some of our speakers were coming out of the time framework, but I really didn't dare to stop them, because only for 2 days is the total time of our comments. Only 2 hours have been allocated for the revision and reviewing of economic problems. As we see, they're very diverse, very deep. They're much more complex, which rather than what they might seem from the first glance. And I really thought that people who came from the north, or those who are dealing with Arctic problems here in the governmental body, here in Seattle, could give more kind of 3D impression to all the present of you what kind of problems we have to deal. And concluding this session, I will make just two very short, brief concluding remarks. Firstly, what was clearly evident from this session, we see that the scale of the problem is really huge. And despite the economic problems which the whole world, is going through, at the political problems which you see in more southern attitudes, well, the Arctic is not losing hopes for a very progressive and high-scale development. Secondly, well, the Arctic, as the global economic region, is not isolated from the rest of the world. We see it exemplified by many examples, maybe the Chinese investments in the north of Krasnoyarsky or in the southern Lapland, two more vivid examples. Nevertheless, what is evident and visible in all presentations, that the potential of cooperation between Arctic states is very high, both on the level of business as well as on the level of national governments in their attitude to business for forming favorable conditions for doing business. Many presenters also that many activities when Arctic Council bring around feasible benefits, so it becomes, well, a positive factor of economic development of this region. And the last thing, my own observation, if I may share with you, and here is a problem. Probably it's the general problem of, you know, coverage of the Arctic problem in Russia as well as other countries. In these 2 days, we heard a lot, much was said about the problems in political, diplomatic spheres, in military and defense spheres. Well, our section had proved and shown that there are very good prospects, and there's a lot of positive experience accumulated in the entrepreneurial community, mainly acting on the premise of the reasonable benefit, and definitely logically they are interested in continuation of cooperation under any political condition, and that might be a very good recommendation for well respect and distinguished Russian international first. Let's analyze this positive experience where we have, you know, coincidence of interest and real productive cooperation. Let's fix our attention and focus on what's really good and positive. Thank you, and thanks to all the speakers.
Andrey Konstantinovich, yeah.
Andrey Konstantinovich, I want to thank you for partly carrying out my mission and for drawing first results of our conference. But nevertheless, I wouldn't take much time. Much of your time, I want to thank all participants of our conference, our guests from abroad, Russian representatives, people who came from the regions, for very constructive, very engaged involvement, discussion, and revision of the Arctic problems. Of course, we're not going to draw all the results today. We'll do it after a while when, you know, we're calming down, including all the analytics expressed here through our work yesterday and today. But what can I say today, right now? Here we had representatives of high-level representatives from all Arctic states. We had representatives from the governments, business, academia, experts, and everybody was unanimous in agreement that the Arctic is our common capital. We must protect it from external threats and challenges which now we're dealing in other parts of the world. In this region, we have all opportunities to develop new forms of cooperation, looking forward into the 21st century, and then these new forms of cooperation to apply for solution of problems in other regions. We must protect and secure this common heritage. And I think this should be a great incentive for our joint work. And I'd like to express thanks and gratitude to our Russian International Affairs Council, which will be paying attention further to this problem. And as you heard today, we already heard three invitations in the March of next year to go to Archangel. And so that will be our next destination. Then we'll continue our joint work. Thank you all.